Yes, we want to be on time. Not just we have to respect your time, but also we have, as I said, we have listeners on the phone, and they took their break when we took ours, but we don't want them waiting for us online. So we want to begin this session. We say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. والصلاة والسلام على الرسول الكريم صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد أيها المسلمون Again, thanking Imam Furqan Muhammad for hosting us for this 2015 Ramadan session here in Atlanta, Georgia at Masjid Mu'minun. And we are expecting, inshallah, tomorrow, Imam Hatim Hamidullah from Orlando to join us. As you all know, he used to live here also in Atlanta, Georgia. Now, what I want to do for this last session, because we will stop at 8:40, maybe 8:45 or so, because the sun doesn't set here to 8:50. I saw it, so close to fast-breaking time. But I had quite a bit of information that I didn't finish in the Jummah. So I said before starting, I'll start what I want to share with you on the theme, my theme for this weekend, the Quran, man's evolution, and his continual advancement. That will be our theme this weekend. But I want to finish what I couldn't finish in Jummah because of the lack of time. So I'm going to read. The subject today was Ramadan, the month of purification. The month of purification. And the basis for our discussion was Surah Al-Ikhlas, the chapter that titles Purity of Faith, and how the revelation of the Quran, its most important correction was the correction of the false idea of God that the world had, not just the Arabs, but that the world had. And also to correct, Imam Muhammad, he put it like this. He said the Quran came to correct what they said God said. Yeah, that's nice, isn't it? Quran comes to correct what they say God said. And he said the same with W.D. Farad. Imam said, if you don't want God to get involved in your thing, whatever it is you're planning and doing and working, remember that Daoud? He said, don't say Bismillah. Don't mention God's name, because he said, the minute you mention Allah's name, you invite him to take over your thing. Yeah. So, they say God said certain things, and Allah says in the Quran, and they write the book with their own hands. Now, this is referring to something now. And they write the book with their own hands, and they say, this is from God. Yeah. So we know who they are, and we are not, this is not for criticism. This is Ramadan for us. And we know that the Christians, the Jews and others are called Ahlil Kitab, people of scripture, people of the book. So they are our brothers and sisters in faith. But we don't agree with their wrong ideas. We respect their goodness, but we don't respect the falsehood. So whatever they wrote with their own hands is unacceptable. So God had to come to the and reveal to the prophet, Al-Ikhlas, purify the faith, we'll take the questions later. Purify the faith and purify man's false concept of God. But now, you know, the Arabs, they weren't the first. They weren't even the only ones. You can go back to ancient Egypt. If any of you all know anything about their religious life, their philosophy, their ideology, you find them having the same issues. The false concept of God, Osiris, Horus, all of that. I'm not, that's not our presentation, that's just to point out that in ancient times, man had the wrong concept of God, and God himself had to reveal to the Prophet Muhammad, as Imam Qasim said in his session, the Prophet is Qatamun Nabiyyin. He's the seal of prophethood. He's the seal of it. But now that also means, and this is important for us, and while we are Muslims, and I don't know if you all, you read the last speech of the Prophet, his last sermon, but most people, when they translate the last sentence, I'd say about the last two to three sentences, probably the latter paragraph, you can, it says a paragraph, but they say, he said, and may those who come later appreciate it better than those who are here. No, he prayed for it in the speech. God, let there be some who come later, the akhirin they call us, who will understand my words better than those who are right here with me right now. Go back and read it. It was a dua near the end of the speech. Well, where are they? Where are those akhirin that he, the akhirin means the later ones. That was 1,400 years ago. It's like Abraham prayed for his offspring. God, give me an offspring who will be righteous. And he prayed for the generations to come. So the Prophet Muhammad, he understood, as Imam Muhammad said, that what he was receiving was more powerful for the mind of the Arab of the 7th century to understand it. They couldn't understand it, the mind of the Arab in the 7th century. Give an example. There's a hadith that references when we are supposed to stop eating and drinking. And the Quran came to correct this now. And it said, eat and drink until the black thread becomes distinct, or the white thread, pardon me, becomes distinct from the black thread. Now that's in this book right here. Or if you have volume 3 of Bukhari, and I saw them on the shelf out there, it's in volume 3. Volume 3 of Sahih Bukhari deals with everything you practically need to know about Ramadan, okay? So in that volume, now this is volume 1 because this is a different collection, but the ones I saw with the 9 volume, it's in book 3. And the Arab, when the Prophet said this, the Quran said it first. The Quran said it. And the person took the Arab, this is in the 7th century, way behind us now. And I'm saying how the mind of the Arabs did not understand completely the Quran, or even the teachings of the Prophet. So he had to pray for people to come later to understand it better than those who were with him. Now I can just go ahead on and say, Allah answered his dua and gave us Imam W.D. Muhammad in this community. Now, don't get upset. I don't get mad. You should be happy that we had something special come to us. And if any people deserved it, Imam Qasim, he read, should a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me this whole people. So if anybody deserve understanding and religion and knowledge of God and create, it's the people who had absolutely all of their knowledge. And I put it like that because I can't say we didn't have anything. Yes, we did. But they poured it out over generations. It kept cutting. Each group was cut off. From the fathers, cut off from al-Islam, cut off from the mothers. Some shipped around plantations, cut off. You all know the history. So what we came with, they made sure that didn't survive. Thank Allah it didn't survive. Because we are new Africans. We ain't old Africans. We are new Africans. Because the Africans, some of them had let superstition come into their practice. I know I have in Dallas, we have some wonderful brothers and sisters from Senegal that are in the masjid there with me. And over the years, they don't hardly do it anymore, but they had a lot of superstitious practices. And they were telling me all kind of witchcraft and voodoo. And I would just simply say, show it to me in the Quran. And before they could even start, I said, hold up, now there's one surah that will correct you. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقَ وَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبَ. This verse. ومن شر النفاثات في العقد and those who practice superstitions. So thank God that old way from West Africa didn't survive with us. I ain't forgot it. I'm on it. I'm on it. I got thread, so I'm stitching. I used to be a tailor. I'm sewing. I got the scriptural garment on the table, and I'm weaving the fabric together. It all connects. That's all right, my friend. You all right? That's my buddy from way back, D.C. Daoud. So it didn't survive. This is Allah's will now that we didn't come with these superstitions. So we were new. And unfortunately now, this is unfortunate part of the Nation of Islam that Lieutenant Larry was in and Lieutenant John 5X was in. We were given mysticism all over again by W.D. Farrar. He mystified everything. Yaqub, the grafting of the devil, all this mysticism, the splitting of the atoms and all of that. He put a blindfold on a blind man. Put mud on our eyes, too. Yeah, put a blindfold on a blind man, already blind. Muck mud. Yeah, so we were blessed. So the prophet said the Al-Kareem. But in his time, to understand this now, that hadith about those threads, an Arab brother, not understanding the religion, took a white piece of thread, black piece of thread, put it under his pillow that night before. So the next day, he told the prophet, peace be upon him, he said, I couldn't make the distinction between the black thread and the white thread. The prophet looked at him, he said, you did what? No, yes, and said, you took literally. Now listen to this now, this is serious. And this will help us, I hope, inshallah. The prophet said, you took a piece of thread, white and black, literally, and put it under your pillow, on your pillow to see the difference. He said, yes. He said, that is not what it means. Listen carefully. You think that's the only thing that they had a problem understanding? I'll give you another one. There's a hadith that says, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed by some rocks. Okay, hold up. The rocks said, As-salamu alaykum. He prayed that the Al-Kareem would understand it better than those who were there. Most people who think literally, well, actually, I've had the discussion with a brother. He said, the rocks brother said, As-salamu alaykum. I said, well, go out here and show me them rocks. I ain't never seen any talking rocks. I want to see the talking rocks. He didn't understand. He thought it literally meant the rock, like their brother thought, little piece of black thread and white thread. So God revealed in the Quran, the black thread of night is distinct from the white thread of Fajr, the dawn. All right? So we're told, eat and drink. But now Imam Muhammad took it on another level of that. He said, but there's a higher reading. Keep on eating. Not your suhoor, your physical food in the morning. It might take you the whole month. It might take you a year before your white thread of understanding break through your darkness of misunderstanding and ignorance on one verse in the Quran. So you have to keep eating the Quran. You have to keep drinking the Quran until the white thread of enlightenment and understanding becomes distinct from mysteries and mysticism. Allahu Akbar. So how long that's going to be for you? I don't know. But Allah said you just keep on eating and drinking until you get it. Not until I get it. Not until Imam Qasim get it. You might have to eat longer than me. You might have to drink longer. But I'm going to say this, and he can say the same thing, and this ain't no boast. This is giving credit, thanks to Allah, and giving credit to our leader, Imam Waliduddin Muhammad. There are no more dark areas in the Quran for me at all. None. No dark areas in the Bible at all. None. No dark areas in Greek mythology, Roman mythology, ancient Egyptian mythology. None. There's no more darkness for me because I took the command. I've been eating and drinking for 40 years. And I ate and drank for 33 years with Imam W.D. Muhammad. So the Quran says, eat and drink until the white thread of the dawning of your intelligence and understanding becomes distinct from darkness of mysteries and mysticism. So because of Imam W.D. Muhammad, and I'm going to tell you something, you have this too, if you have the same confidence, because how many of us were listening to Imam Muhammad from 1975? Raise your hand. Look at all of these people. Okay. You don't even know what's inside of you. That's right. You don't even know. It's like the Arabs with the oil. They thought the earth was cursed. Black soil used to come up on the ground. And they say, oh, this is cursed. This earth is cursed. White man came from California in the 1940s. 42, 44. You can find this online. It's in a book called The Kingdom by Robert Baer. CIA agent wrote this book. It's a movie too. I read the book a long time ago. And he said that when the white man, the Western man with science now, the oil was there all the time. It was there when Allah created the earth. And they used to see it, but they had not the science or the technology to understand what it was and to extrapolate it and put it to good use. White man came from the West, California, went to Saudi Arabia, spent years, failure after failure, continually, millions of dollars lost, lives lost. It got so bad, the executives in California say, shut it down. These are dry holes, dry wells producing nothing. One of them said, let's try one more time. We can't stop now. Let's try one more time. And he said, but we have hit every well. It's nothing here. But see, the problem was, like I told you, you got things you don't even know. They weren't drilling deep enough. They were drilling shallow wells. They were drilling black thread, white thread on a pillar kind of wells. You get it. They were drilling rock say assalamu alaikum kind of wells. They were not rasikuna. R-A-S-E, chapter 3, verse 7. R-A-S-E-E, Rasikuna, K-H-U-N-A. Rasikuna. What's a Rasik? A Rasik is a deep dweller. Critical thinker like Abraham, the Imam Carson was referring to. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, God forgive him his sin and grant him paradise, he said, brother, don't think you got it by looking at it one time. Who remember that? I remember that. Keep on looking at it. Keep on studying, brother. You might be right. You might be right. And he said, think five times. They go to five senses and five prayers. Remember that? Think five times before you speak. What was he trying to get us to do? Be rasik. Be a deep oil dweller. A driller. So they were drilling too shallow. So the oil was there, but it was deep beneath the earth. And one of them said, let's try drilling a little deeper. And they went to what is called the Mamma number 7. And they dropped that drill bit down beneath about 4,600 feet. They had not gone that far. They dropped it deep into the earth's core. And black oil gushed forth. Our oil is deeper than you got it. You know where I'm going. And Imam said, we have the oil, the wisdom of the Quran. Allah gave them that black oil in the earth, and he gave us the oil of understanding of the Quran. But you got to drill deep. You ain't going to get nothing on the surface. You have to become a rasik. That's in the Quran. I'm not making it up. Chapter 3, verse 7. Rasikuna fi ilm. Those who are deep thinkers in the sciences. They read the Quran, But they're not just running through it. I got to hurry up and finish my jewels. What? It took the prophet 23 years to get what you're trying to finish in 30 days. And you're rushing through. You're not understanding the value. You're not understanding the richness of what you have. And you're just tossing, what do you mean Muhammad said aside? Won't even use it. Won't go in and study it. Well, you're not going to get any oil unless you drill deep. They hit the mam number 7. That 7 is interesting, isn't it? It could have been 3, 4, 5, whatever. It could have been any number. Well, but they said the one that gushed forth oil was those 7 verses of Al-Fatiha. Now, they didn't say that. I put that in. Allah says in the Quran of the rocks, the prophet prayed for the Akarina to understand it better than those who were with him. Allah said, with that staff too, that you were talking about, Moses, strike the rock. What rock was that? The rocks out there in the street? No, the hard hearts of the Hebrews. 12 tribes. And it says, and out gush forth 12 springs. Now listen to this carefully now. Bilal will be able to get this. And those of you who study finance, how many Federal Reserve districts in America? 12. It's in their Torah. And each one knew its place of watering, cash flow. So the water for them is the liquidity, liquid, cash. But they understand it. See, they're deep. They're Rasix. Their rabbis are Rasix. They say, okay. Now, I hope you ain't like the ancient people in the 7th century or back in 3,000 years ago when you think God just told Moses to hit a piece of rock. If the rock was strong enough and his stick wasn't strong enough, the rock would have broke his stick. But obviously he had a staff that was stronger than that rock, meaning their hearts. How do we know? Allah says in the Quran, there are some hearts that are harder than rocks because from some rocks water flows. But from some people, you can't get no sentiments out of them at all. They ain't going to smile. I don't care if the sun is out there all day long. They're going to be grouchy, look dead, look pessimistic, and everything is going with Ramadan. How you doing, brother? Oh, man, I got to be going through these fasts for 29 days. Well, you blowing your fast. I'll be glad when the sun set. Because I can't wait to get my water and my food. Is that your spirit? You might as well going to break yours. You ain't fasting. You done broke it. Your spirit is bad. You misunderstand what it is. Now, think now. Behind us, what we're seeing on TV, is because they are having a mind from the 7th century with no understanding. So they're going to the Hadith. Stone the adulterer. Well, they read one line. The second line says, the Jews came to Prophet Muhammad and asked him, what should they do to the woman who committed adultery? He said, do whatever your book say do. He told them, do whatever their book say do. If you read the Old Testament or the Torah, it has in it stoning for the adultery. You know what else is in there? And I know they ain't gonna put that on TV. Killing the homosexual. That's in the Old Testament. That's not in the Quran now. It's not in the Quran. It's not in the Hadith. But in the Bible, it said if a man lay with another man, kill them both. Well, who going to do that? Who going to carry out that law? Man, these homosexuals powerful now. You're going to be in jail. They got judges. They got judges on their side. They got judges in their camp. What, you think the Supreme Court could pass the same-sex marriage if some of them didn't have the same problem?
That ain't the Supreme Court. That's the low court. This is the supreme knowledge. And God's court is the Supreme Court. Allahu Akbar. So we're religious people. We're not gonna capitulate like the Episcopalians. They just passed it the other day. All their bishops got together and they decided that it's okay to have same-sex marriage in the Episcopalian church. You can't get two imams together to decide that. Because one of them gonna say, you lost your mind.
That's right.
Yeah, he might get stoned. And stoning is not in the Quran at all. Seventh century mentality. The man who came to the prophet, prayer and peace be upon him. Now I'm talking, don't forget where I'm at now. I'm finishing up the Jummah that I had with the purity of faith, and Ramadan is the month of purification. These ideas, I couldn't give it all to you in Jummah. We didn't have time. But there was another man in the Hadith. He came to the prophet while some of his companions was around. He said, Ya Rasulullah, oh messenger of God, I am ruined. The prophet said, what do you mean you're ruined? I have committed zina. That's adultery and fornication, same word. The prophet turned his head right quick. The man followed him. Didn't you hear what I said? I just said I committed zina. Prophet turned his head again and probably gave him a look like, do you know who's standing around me? These people don't have my understanding. he turned his head again. The man followed him. He said, I have committed. And the man said, like that. Like he was startled. Because he really got it that the prophet didn't want to hear it. And he was trying to avoid his companions listening to this. Without doing anything, the man took off running. This is in the Hadith now. But see, this is the 7th century stuff. They took off running. The man took off running. The people, the brothers who were with the prophet didn't tell them anything. They chased this man down. Stoned him to death. Listen carefully. When they came back, they told the prophet. See, that's why Imam Qasim was saying earlier, reading from the Quran, Muhammad the prophet is Uswatun Hasanah. Not Baghdadi, the one who wants the caliphate. Not Mullah so-and-so, Sheikh so-and-so. No, the prophet is the example. Because if you don't take that example, you're going to go astray now. They came back and they told the prophet. They were happy. I'm just using my imagination because I read the Hadith. And it was like they were happy. Hey, yeah, we got him. I guess that's how they said it. I don't know, in Arabic. The prophet was startled. He said, you all did what? They said, we stoned him to death. This is where these 7th century brothers get this now. It's not in the Quran. Tell me what the Quran says. What does the Quran say is the punishment? 100 lashes. Now I'm going to ask you a question. If you lash somebody physically with a whip 100 times in Atlanta, Georgia, are you going to be walking around free or are you going to jail for assault? You're going to jail. And put on TV, these crazy Muslims. What street is this? Hank Aaron Boulevard. Over there whipping people, taking the Quran literally. And they don't understand that a tongue lashing sometimes hurt worse than a whip. But listen carefully. If you tongue lash somebody in America, in public, you slander them, you defame them, you're going to be in court. You're going to be in court. So you can't, you have to understand the Quran now. So the Prophet Muhammad, prayers and peace be upon him, he said, you all should not have stoned him. Now, they won't tell you this part. He said, when the man turned and ran, like O.J. Simpson, he realized the consequences of his wrong. There was no need to stone him. Because remember, they would not have known what the man did except what? He told them. And the prophet was trying to kill this priesthood. No, I don't want to hear that. I'm not a priest. There's no priesthood in Al-Islam. There's no hierarchy. What are you telling me this for? You need to be repenting to God. And you don't know these people standing around me don't have my understanding. Now I ask you, based on what we're watching and witnessing in the media, if we're to believe it, is there any indication from the people they are showing us that they understand the Quran and the life of Muhammad the Prophet?
No.
No. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. No. I told a Christian friend of mine, I said, you know, I thank God I've been a Muslim for 40 years. Alhamdulillah. And I told him, I said, I have read the Quran from cover to cover to cover to cover to cover to cover. And I said, now I read it in Arabic. I know how to look the words up in language. I said, I've studied the hadith of the Prophet. I've studied his history. I told my Christian friend, I cannot recognize at all any semblance of Islam by what they are doing overseas. Can't recognize it. Now, you don't know this, so I have to tell you this, and this is no boast, but I'm going to share with you how Allah blessed us in our community, man, Muhammad. I was in Egypt in 1988. And the adhan was called, and I was looking for the bathroom to make wudu. So there's about, I don't know, 100, 200 brothers in the lobby of this building. And I could speak Arabic, conversational Arabic, too. So I says, Wayne Hammam. You got to make sure you say that right, because if you say Wayne Hammam, it's where's the pigeon? You have to say Wayne Hammam, Hammam. That's the bathroom. So I said this. This is a true story now. This was in 1988, long before all this madness. I'm in Egypt, guest of President Hosni Mubarak at that time, representing our community, alhamdulillah. All expenses paid for 2 weeks. I didn't pay for anything to be over there. Wrote a paper for Al-Azhar, doing dawah in minority communities. I wrote a paper. My paper is at Al-Azhar in Egypt. Was there since 1988, alhamdulillah. The imam told me I could go. They paid my way over there. The king, not the king, the president at the time. Met him in Dallas. Spoke to him in Arabic. Gave him a copy of Imam W.D. Muhammad's book, Mubarak. I said to the brother, I want to make wudu. Do you know what this man says to me? True story, Allah is my witness. You want hashish? You know what hashish is? Weed. That's weed for us. What's weed? That's weed. He's. So I'm like, the thing was just made. I said, what? Lie. He said, you want girl? You want girl? Now remember, I asked him where the bathroom was at. I know the word for girl. I didn't say nothing about Wayne Bent. I know the word for hashish, just say hashish. I didn't say any of this. I said, Wayne Hammam, where is the bathroom? He says, you want girl? You want girl? I said, la. La, I don't want a girl. Guess what he said after that? This is Egypt. You want the boy? You want the boy? I said, man, have you lost your mind? I'm in Egypt. I said, have you lost your mind? Now I'm from America. The only thing came over me at that moment, Allah is my witness. I shouted out in the lobby with no fear. Wayne al-Islam fi Misr. Loud as I could say it. There had to be about 100, 200 Egyptians there. And I said it again. Wayne al-Islam fi Misr. Where is al-Islam in Egypt? And they jumped, they're running, brother, you don't see Muslims? I said, I see plenty of Muslims. That's not my question. My question is, where is al-Islam in this nation? Because you all don't seem to be able to display it. Now, there wasn't on TV. I'm telling you what happened before all this stuff even got on TV. That these people were operating just from rituals. The religion just became rituals for them. So if all you doing, washing your hands. I was at a masjid the other day in Jacksonville, Florida, immigrant community. The brother got his feet. They got a few little sinks to wash. He stuck his foot in the sink. I said, I can't take it no more. I did. I said, I can't take it. So, you know, but you got to be tactful now because you never know what kind of mind you're dealing with. So I asked. I said, do you mind if I suggest something to you? He said, oh, no. I said, Muhammad the Prophet, prayers and peace be upon him, used the least amount of water as possible to wash his make wudu. Can you please take your feet out that sink because we have to wash our face in that sink? You know what he did? He said, oh, thank you. Took his foot out the sink. And I said, alhamdulillah, I didn't get attacked, bum rush. He accepted it, the correction. Okay, but this is a ritual. And the purity now, and I'm looking at the time. So I'm just going to give you the reference. That's chapter 5, verse 6. I was going to give you this in Jumu'ah today, but I couldn't. It's a long verse. About to wrap this up. You go read it. It tells you what to wash of the wudu, right? And if you in ceremonial impurity, use the word impurity, that means with your spouse, then full bath, ghusl. It's called ghusl, right? And if you cannot, listen to this. This is Quran, chapter 5, verse 6. And if you cannot find clean water, get you some clean earth and perform what? Tayammum. And how do you perform tayammum? You just take a little bit. Remember now, they're sticking their feet in sinks. Allah said, take just a little dirt. Brush it off like that. Now look. And just wipe it on your face. You don't need to do head, ears, arm to the elbow, feet. Just a little like that. And you clean, because the earth is not dirty. The earth is clean. Mm-hmm. Now you might pollute it, but before you pollute it with sewer, the earth is clean. So God says, take you some clean earth to tell us there's nothing wrong with your flesh. This is addressing something high. In the scriptures that came before, that the flesh was sinful, the matter is sinful, the earth is sinful. God said, is it? Well, I'm going to tell Muhammad's followers, you can clean yourself up with some of that earth. They call it nasty. Ain't nothing wrong with your dirt, with that dirt. But however, if you're believing this verse in the Quran is just talking about the ritual, you're not a rasikh. Imam W.D. Muhammad was a member of the rasikhuna. And he made us who were open ears and open mind, males and females, rasikhunas. We're not satisfied to give us something on the surface. We're going to drill deep because we're looking for oil. And sometimes you ain't going to get it on the surface. You got to go deep, right? So wash your hands. Your mama told you that. You need revelation to tell you to wash your hands? My grandmother told me that. Wash clean your actions. Now it has meaning. And wash your face. My mama told me that. But she didn't tell me. The face is symbolic of your personality. And this cleaning of the face is symbolic of cleaning your personality. So the washing of the face is really to wash my personality. Because, well, listen, if you wash your face and as soon as you make wudu, brother, move. Oh, you didn't have wudu. Your personality is still dirty. Sister, you had the same chemo on yesterday. When you going to get a new one? Now, this is a person standing at the wudu station. You had that on yesterday. What is this? You are dirty inside. Though you're washing your hands and your face. See, those are rituals. And wash your feet. Well, that's scripture before. And Mary. What time is it? This ain't getting freaky now. This is just the scripture before. She washed his feet with her hair and her tears. What? Brother? You ever had your feet washed with your wife's hair and her tears? That's a scene there, boy. Men dream of. Jesus is getting it. But they tell us he didn't have a woman. Well, he got a woman washing his feet. She doing more than your woman that you got. With her hair and her tears. So then the Muslims have to wash our feet. But now you can't get no woman to do this. You got to do it yourself. But Allah bless Imam Wahiduddin Muhammad to explain this. This principle of purification. Feet are the lowest elements in society. When we stand up, the head is up here, the feet is at the bottom in our body. So the body in society, the leaders are the head of society, the masses are the feet. And this picture, Imam Muhammad said, of this woman washing the feet says that you should give the masses with your hair knowledge and tears be concerned about them. Those are the, that's just a picture of what we are supposed to be doing, what people in the world are supposed to be doing who claim they're religious. Okay, well, wash the feet. Take care of the people in the ghetto. Take care of the people in the valley with your knowledge and your concerns, your tears. So when we wash our feet, it's symbolic of I'm concerned about the lower classes of people. I have to help them. I have to help them clean up their life. I have to help my brothers and my sisters and my cousins and my uncles and my nieces and my nephews. I got to do whatever I can to help them. Because Lil Wayne is on their back. Rihanna is on their back. Beyonce is on their back. They're having a hard time. They don't know how to feel. They have no filter. So they succumb to it. So now, the Rossic, this is what you get as a Rossic. Deep, to go deep to understand this. And it has other meanings too. Clean the lower rungs of society also. Don't treat your prisoners bad when you get them in prison. They're the feet. Take care of them too. Yeah, I know they committed a crime. Yeah, I know you have them in captivity. But they are still human beings. Yes. And they still have human dignity. Even though they committed a crime, they are not a criminal. Listen to me carefully. Never accept that you are a criminal. God said, I created you in the most excellent mode. We were pure when we came here. Look at the babies. They're running around. Pure. Innocent. No sin. No corruption. None of these babies have it. Oh, so the brother you talking to was born that way? Hey, really? Homosexual? No, you ain't got to get all worked up. Don't let veins come through your neck. Just say, brother, I tell you what. Can you go with me to Grady Hospital? Because I'm confused. I need you to show me the homosexual laying up in the nursery. Because I can't identify him. Can you take me there and show me that baby? And point him out. Say, that's going to be the homosexual right there. Who can do that? And what mother carries her child home after delivering this child for 9 months? Carrying it for 9 months and delivering it, all this pain. And then she introduced her child to her family members. Here's my little homosexual Michael. Who does that? So no concept of original sin. There's no such thing as original sin. There's original purity. Fitrah, Imam Qasim shared with us. So everybody is born pure, clean, no sin. The sin comes later when we come into the world of mankind. And are you aware of the hadith with Angel Jibreel when Allah created the world the first time? And had Angel Jibreel to look at it. And he said, oh, what a beautiful world. How can any creature go wrong in a world made so wonderful? And then Allah showed him the world after the Satan influences the world. And let me put my finger here so I can give you a note on Satan, the Imam told us. And Imam Qasim probably remember this. After Satan got into the world. And then Allah said, look at it now. And Jibreel said, oh, my Lord. He recognized Allah as his Lord, not Jesus. He said, oh, this ain't Jesus talking either. He said, oh, my Lord, how can any creature go right in a world made like this? Now, here's one of these other 7th century myths. The jinn. Okay. Well, you can believe what you want to believe of the jinn. But I'm going to tell you what the prophet said. He said, everyone possess a jinn. And they said, even you, O messenger of God? He said, yes, I possess a jinn also. But Allah has blessed me to make my jinn obedient. Mine makes salat. Mine fast Ramadan. I made mine Muslim. Okay, well, you can believe like the man told me when he first came, when the Imam opened the community up and everybody could come. I was in Jacksonville, Florida, Saeed. It was in 1975, 76. Latif was there. We were in a circle. Bilal, all us sitting. We had the Tablik Jamaah visit us in Jacksonville, Florida. And we're sitting in a circle. They came from Pakistan. And they stayed at the masjid. I let them stay at the masjid. I'm rushing fast because I'm watching the time. One of them said, they start telling us, they like to tell you stories about their ancestors and what their teachers told them. I listened to some good stories. He said, I want to tell you a story of the jinn. He attacked the sister who went into the bathroom without her hair cover on. Well, I'm listening to this. Latif, man, blah. So I'm sitting. That's in 1976. I'm not a Rasik at all at that point. I don't even know how to spell Rasik. I don't even know what it is. But I got common sense. So I'm sitting there. And I'm listening. I'm like, what? He said, and the lady went to the bathroom. Muslim. She left her kimar outside the bathroom. The jinn jumped on her and attacked her in the bathroom. Well, I'm like, what kind of jinn? What jinn kind of little freaky jinn, isn't it? Yeah, jinn not going off, man. So I'm listening. Now, my common sense kicked in. So I got to ask a question. I said, well, how did he look? I got to ask a question. Allah is my witness. Ask Latif. He's from Jacksonville. Oh, he was about this tall. Hold up. That ain't the worst. Ain't the worst part of it. So I said, well, how did he look? Because he didn't describe the height. He was green. 1976, I believe. You know what I said? I said, man. No. I said, at that time, that movie was out. I said, that sounds like The Exorcist. Oh, because he said this is the rest of it. He said, so I said, well, what happened to her? Well, the lady had to go to the imam, and the imam, he pulled the jinn out of her. That's what he told me. I said, he did? Now I'm looking incredulous now. I said, what? He got the jinn out of her? Yes, he pulled him out. So now I couldn't take it anymore, Saeed. I said, you know what you telling me? I said, you know what that sounds like? The Exorcist. The movie with Linda Blair in it back then. That movie had just come out. I said, it sounds like a Hollywood movie. Now, listen to what he did after I said this now. I said, that sounds like a Hollywood movie. Exorcist with Linda Blair with some little green thing coming out, and the priest went in there and pulled out this demon out of her. You know, I couldn't watch the whole movie back then. I saw part of it. When the green thing came out, that was the end of it for me. I was like, I'm done. I don't know what else coming out, but I ain't going to stay around to watch it. That was 76. So he laughed. Listen to this. You don't believe me? I said, not at all. That was it. Now later, it took me going to Dallas, Texas in the 90s. I told this story to a Pakistani friend of mine. You know what he said? He said, Imam, you know what they tell us back home? I said, what? He said, they tell us when we go to America, among the black people who call themselves Muslims, tell them anything and they'll believe it. I said, what? He said, but you didn't fit that stereotype. He said, because you questioned him and you didn't believe it. That's why he started laughing. Hey, they think we stupid. But now I think there's something wrong with you. If you telling people during Ramadan, listen, this is what I heard on the news. This is the best time to kill people because you get extra brownie points, bonus points in paradise if you kill somebody in Ramadan. Now you stupid. You heard this on the news. So they're telling these people overseas, kill people during Ramadan. This is the fast month. This is the least time you're supposed to be killing people. The prophet said if somebody assault you, say, inni sa'im, I am fasting. If somebody argue, I am fasting. If somebody get upset, I am fasting. He didn't say kill somebody, you're going to get some virgins in paradise. And they're all over the news laughing at the Muslims. Say, yeah, I heard it on the way coming over here. Oh, yeah, this is Ramadan. This is on CNN. Yeah, this is Ramadan. And they believe if they kill somebody in Ramadan, they're going to have 72 virgins in paradise. Well, that's not in the Quran. That's not in the Hadith. I don't know. Hold up. I think that's one of those legends, like that guy told me in 1976 about that green gin. I think that's the same kind of story about them 72 virgins. Now, I don't know a brother in here. I'm just going to speak for myself. I can't speak for y'all because I don't know y'all. What am I going to do with 72 people? 72 females? What? It ain't but 30 days in the month. What you going to do with that? I can't imagine it. I just can't imagine it. I can't imagine it. I can't imagine those 72 virgins. Even in paradise, I can't imagine. I'd be like, Allah, I don't need that. I got other things I want to do. I don't need no 72 females. I'm going to do with 72 women. Hold on a second. Hold on. Now think about this now. The image of Al-Islam is being given by people who have a 7th century mentality. So the prophet, he's a prophet. This is where I wanted to end up, Dawood. He's a prophet speaking prophetically in the future too. So in the last speech, he makes a dua. Because he understands his people ain't ready. It's going to have to come another people. That's in the Quran too. Allah says, if you don't act right, you don't do it right, I will create another people. And they will not be like you. They won't fear the criticisms of the criticizers. They will love God and God will love them. Well, I don't know anybody love God more than us. I just don't know. I guess I'm biased because I'm an African American. But I don't know anybody with the soul and the spirit for love for God than us. I don't know of a group. Look, in the news, in my hometown, Charleston, South Carolina, where I was born. Charleston, too, Said, crazy terrorists. Well, you kill black people, you ain't no terrorist. Unless you are Arab. Well, hold up. Sit with those people for 1 hour. Now listen carefully. Imam Muhammad told us this. He said, the Quran is not just to be left on the pages of a book. He said, look for the real life circumstances in the world because the scripture is alive. So when I heard that he sat for 1 hour with those angelic people, those people studying the word of God, I said, wow. Iblis pretended to be among the angels. He pretended to be with them, listening for 1 hour to the word of God. And then he couldn't stay with the word anymore. The word, I guess, was too much for him. So then Iblis had to show himself. He was pretending to be among. So now, You want to understand that in one context? That's a context to see that in. It's a live example in Charleston, South Carolina. But here's what I want to conclude with. He wipes out all them people in the church. The heart, the African-American heart. They go to court. Look at him and say, you kill my mama. You kill my granddaddy. You kill my son. And I forgive you. Now, I cringed. I said, hold up. That's too soon. No. But I know where it's coming from. The scripture. Pray for those who despitefully use you. That's in the Bible. That's not in the Quran. The Quran don't say anything. Make a dua for somebody who spitefully use you. No. Allah says in the Quran, and death is better than oppression. So I can't imagine. God, I pray I never have to go through it. Pray Allah, God forbid it. Any of us have to go through that. But I guarantee you, I ain't going to court to forgive you. You just killed my relative. And I'm going to show up the next day, the next 2 days. But that shows you the depth of the African-American heart. On the other side of it, it shows you the capacity in the heart of the African American. And if the Arabs in Palestine, Syria, elsewhere would just get half, a quarter of the capacity that we had that brought us out of worse conditions than anything they ever experienced at the hands of the Israelis. We are a model example, sometimes to the extreme, sometimes to our own detriment. We shall overcome. Walk. We still shall overcome. Walk. We shall overcome twice. Walk. Well, I'm out. I can't say we should overcome. You done knocked me out. Nowhere, with a couple of exceptions, and I'm done. Nowhere in the 300, 400 year history did we produce any terrorists with the exception of a few. Nat Turner, Denmark Vesey, that was a co-founder of that church. I didn't know he was a co-founder of that church. He was leading a slave revolt, and somebody in the church stitched on it. And so they hung 35 of them back in the 1810 and 1812, and Denmark Vesey was one of them. So we have two. He didn't even get a chance to carry out his terrorist act. And I wouldn't have called it terrorism. I would have called it a revolution. Freedom fighter. Nat Turner was a revolutionary freedom fighter. But now how many of them that you can point to that went to those extremes in 400 years? I can't even come up with hardly no more name. Well, the Black Panther, man, stop with them. I call them the Black Pansies. But even them, they weren't to the extreme like that. So look at us. We are the model for how you overcome oppression. We don't have to go to the 7th century. No, look at these African Americans. Look at how God has brought us up, took the slave shackles off of us. And tomorrow, inshallah, I'm going to read chapter 7, 157, and give you Imam Muhammad's commentary, brief commentary on how God, the prophet, told him, take the yokes off their necks. And those yokes were taken off of us physically, but the most important ones that were removed was the false worship, the ones mentally. Our faith was purified coming from those plantations, and it was purified twice. Huh? Imam W.D. Muhammad. See, the Imam Elijah Muhammad took us away from worshiping a white man as God. Now, he threw some corruption in black man God, as Imam Qasim said. But then we had to be purified again. So Imam Muhammad came and gave us Tawheed, the purity, al-ikhlas, the purity of our faith. And he purified it. And guess what? None of us will ever accept false worship ever again in our life. Allahu Akbar. You can't sell us false gods. We ain't buying. We don't care if they're on clearance sale. We still don't want it. As-salamu alaykum.
Allahu Akbar.
Allahu Akbar. Now, let me say this. We will have Imam Qasim's lecture from his session is on the table, on his table already. So if you want to get that, we have DVDs of 15, CDs of 10. And this presentation I just completed will be on the table this evening also. And then we'll be back here tomorrow, inshallah, at 11 o'clock. Now, remember I said from 11 to 12, write your questions. So we're going to take 1 hour in the morning to start. And we will answer any questions you have. So you can bring it. You don't need a card. You can just lay it on the table. Put a piece of paper on the table. We don't want to take questions from the audience. We want you to write it down on a piece of paper, and then we can answer. That's how Imam W.D. Muhammad used to do it at the Ramadan sessions. He would have the questions brought, and then he would go through them and see which ones he wanted to answer. So that's how we want to do it also. Okay? Tomorrow at 11 o'clock. So we got, what time is the break? 8:54? All right, you got 10 minutes before the iftar, so we can come out and patronize.